Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Dr. Ezekiel Emanuel, a leading bioethicist and vice provost at the University of Pennsylvania, about the ethics and the logistics of distributing a COVID-19 vaccine. This week, Dr. Emanuel was appointed to President-elect Joe Biden's coronavirus task force. Let's listen.
Zeke Emanuel, thank you so much for joining me.
My pleasure. Good to be here.
So today we're going to talk about the distribution of COVID vaccines, of course, once we get an approved COVID vaccine. I'd like to ask you first about who will be getting it and how it will be distributed. But let's start with who.
Well, we don't know is the short answer. At least at this point, the bodies that control it haven't made a final decision. We do have some recommendations from the national academies and other groups around, but you know, the official word, as it were, it has not been determined. But the National Academy has suggested that we start off the list in 1A with frontline healthcare workers, other first responders, and then we move down the list in terms of vulnerability.
I know you're an ethicist, so talk to me about where you think that we should be distributing the vaccines, to whom we should be distributing.
Well, I do think that our primary focus has to be, I mean, there are two primary foci, as it were, and some of this is going to depend upon the vaccine characteristics. One of the foci is mortality and premature mortality and, you know, people who are vulnerable to getting the virus and getting very, very sick and potentially dying. We know that there's a very strong age correlation, so the older you are, the much higher your risk of death is. We also know that there's a strong correlation with comorbidities, so that people who have serious illnesses like diabetes or heart disease are also at very high risk of dying. Obviously, age is age, but comorbidities span the age spectrum, and so you get a very different pool of potential vaccine recipients if you focus on comorbidities. There's also the issue of reducing transmission, which is different. You might not impact mortality directly, but you'll do it indirectly. And if you're trying to impact transmission, the age distribution could look very, very different. For example, we know that in influenza, young children are the spreaders, even if they're usually not at high risk given influenza, and similarly in coronavirus, they may be the spreaders, even if they're not at high risk themselves of getting sick.
I would think that it might be simple enough to give the vaccine to older people, right? You say everybody over 65, you're first in line. But it seems to me it's a much more difficult proposition to say, okay, everybody over 65 and those with diabetes and those with heart disease, you get it. I mean, how does one develop a system like that?
Well, I think you're pointing to, you know, two different dimensions that need to be considered. One dimension is an ethical dimension. Who ought to get it? And that in some ways is separate from the practicality dimension is how do we do it efficiently with the minimum intrusion and the minimum judgment calls? And I think what you're pointing out is, look, it's easy to determine someone's age. They come in with a driver's license or some other ID. And that's a relatively easy determination to make, not bureaucratic, pretty objective. On the other hand, do you have comorbidities require some medical judgment? Now, in the past, when it's been done, that has typically relied on self-attestation. I have diabetes. But you can imagine that there could be some serious problems of who's got, say, two comorbidities? Do we want to rely on self-attestation? How good is self-attestation in actually identifying the high-risk people who you want to get it. And remember, that's not a trivial concern, because if the goal here is to reduce the number of people who are dying prematurely, then if you rely on self-attestation and it's not very accurate, it's not, you're not going to be achieving your goal, and that'll be a problem. So I think you have raised a practical issue which impinges on the ethical and ultimate concerns we have in distributing a vaccine. I might say one of the things which might distinguish this vaccine from many others in the past is the fact that we have such a huge pool of people who are hesitant. And so we're spending, us bioethicists, health policy people, public health people, a lot of time worrying about prioritization and who ought to get it and what are the criteria we should use. And it may be that, you know, we're going to throw the party and no one comes or very few people come. I do have this, I have to say, it's been a dream of mine or coming in dreams, which is you've got this vaccine, you've got whatever, you know, 15, 16 million doses. You give it to first responders who you can relatively easily identify at the hospital, EMTs, et cetera. But then you might have a pool of millions of doses and people are like, hesitant. Yeah, give it to him first or her first and I'll watch. And then if it looks safe, you know, then I might be inclined. And so we could have this crazy situation of we have this life-threatening illness and we have a vaccine that has been proven, at least to the satisfaction of an independent advisory committee and a lot of other people, and yet the public could still be sufficiently hesitant that there's vaccine waiting for people, not people waiting for vaccine. And I think that's an issue we just don't know, but I think it's not an implausible scenario that could happen. As I say, I do have this dream, and it literally is a dream. That's what woken me up several times that, you know, wow, we could be sitting on millions of doses and people won't take them. And we do know that in H1N1, a decade ago, we did produce a lot of vaccine and then, you know, it sort of passed and the urgency disappeared and we ended up having a lot of vaccine.
In this case, I know in coronavirus, minority communities are disproportionately impacted. Is it also more challenging to reach them in some ways?
Well, I think there are, again, two issues, an ethical issue and a practical issue. And the ethical issue is, ought you to target or reserve, as it were, a number of vaccines for minority communities on the idea that they have been at high risk of getting cases, high risk of hospitalization, and high risk of death. And that would seem, if your goal is both to reduce transmission and to reduce mortality, there would seem to be a good ethical justification for targeting them. And then there's a practical consideration of, well, you might target them, but again, there's a lot of vaccine hesitancy and worry, I think, within that community. The trust level, for many, many good reasons, going back, you know, many, many decades, you know, people often say going back to Tuskegee, but it's way before Tuskegee that we've had, I think that community has been mistreated or poorly treated. That raises a lot of suspicions and lack of trust. And I know that the Black Physicians Organization has set up its own independent group to look at the data and evaluate it. And I think that's terrific. If that's a way that's going to enhance trust in the community, absolutely. But this points out that, you know, distributing a vaccine and administering it requires more than just having it and having it in syringes. There's a communication strategy, there's a trust building strategy, there's getting it out to people who are influencers and opinion leaders. I think in this situation, it's going to be absolutely pivotal that celebrities, sports stars, you know, hip hop recording artists, prominent Black politicians, all of them endorse it, look at the data, look at committees that have reviewed the data, get it themselves and get it themselves pretty prominently. You know, it's kind of the analog of the get out the vote push that has occurred just in this 2020 election. We're going to need that kind of big campaign, big communication strategy that's targeted to very different communities to overcome the hesitancy. And as there's good reasons for the hesitancy.
Well, I think also, you know, we're talking about who should get it and how we get it out to people. Because the other question is distribution, right? I mean, the actual physical act of getting these doses out into the community, like how do they get delivered and are there syringes and do we have the right freezers if certain vaccines are the ones that are approved? I saw that the CDC estimates that state and local officials need $6 billion to do that. So that's a question that we haven't heard a lot of answers to.
Well, we at the Center for American Progress, my colleague Topher Spiro and I created a report about the whole challenges and where the potential barriers are related to the distribution. You know, just manufacturing a vaccine does not solve problems, right? You have to actually put it in a special glass vial that's temperature sensitive. You have to have enough stoppers. You have to have what's called fill finish capacity. It has to be put in those glass vials in a super sterile manner so that there's no fungal or other infections growing on it. You then have to ship it out. Different vaccines require different temperatures. So the Pfizer vaccine requires minus 70, minus 80 degrees Celsius over, you know, liquid nitrogen temperature. Other vaccines are minus 20. Those kind of temperatures, certainly the minus 80 degrees Celsius, physician offices can't handle that. Many pharmacies can't handle that. And so you will need a special distribution system for that. And I know that Pfizer's been working extremely hard to have that network and isn't going to go through the usual, that is the network set up by the government through McKesson. And so this is a whole other very important problem, challenge, and the stability, establishing the stability and potency of the vaccines during transportation is going to be absolutely pivotal. Having a vaccine that, you know, becomes impotent and administering it, you know, defeats the entire purpose.
So how will we overcome that?
Part of it is money, as you point out. Part of it is logistics. We have the world's best logistics here in the United States between, you know, Amazon and UPS and FedEx and Walmart and all the, you know, the military. There is terrific logistics, but getting the logistics married up with the healthcare system, married up with the cold chain, you know, this is a big challenge. And, you know, it's going to be a challenge to the government when this happens. And I think hopefully we'll have solved all the barriers there to making sure it works.
It seems, though, that we are not just waiting for approval of a vaccine, but we are waiting to make sure these steps are in place. So even if you get an approval for a vaccine, it's not like the next day we're going to be able to start handing it out.
Yes. So I think, again, the public may or may not appreciate between the end of a trial or where the Data Safety Monitoring Board says, oh, we've got a signal that this is effective, putting the paperwork, sending it to the FDA, having the FDA, both the independent advisory committee, the career officials, and then the commissioner approve it, that's going to take time. That's not going to happen instantaneously, even with people working their heart outs because they know how important this is. And then, as you point out, between that approval and shipping is also going to be a challenge. Production has, in many cases, preceded approval. That, you know, people talk about producing the vaccine at risk. Nonetheless, that's different than shipping it to the point of administration. It's different than having enough people who are ready to administer it. It's different than having a communication strategy that's in place to get the right people to show up at the right time. It's also different than having the technology to track people. Remember, one of the challenges of this vaccine, we haven't talked about it, is it won't be a one-dose vaccine. At least the initial vaccines being tested, Pfizer and Moderna and AstraZeneca, they're two shots in the arm. The J&J is, I believe, a one-shot vaccine. And I know that Merck is working on an oral vaccine. So, you know, those are also going to be having the tracking system and the electronics and the IT infrastructure to track people, to contact them if they don't show up for the second shot. Those are all really important infrastructure elements too, and we'll be testing that since a lot of that IT infrastructure will be new as well.
I guess we also have to track to see if people get sick from it.
The safety element is huge.
Right.
Correct. We're only going to, you know, say you've got 40 or 30, 40, 50,000 people in the trials, right? You'll have a signal, a control group, and then a signal from the people, half of the people who are getting the vaccine as to how different the side effects are. Now, some of the side effects could be the same. Everyone's going to get an injection in the arm that causes a little pain, might cause some fever, but the sort of longer term side effects, we won't know. And we're going to have to follow people and really find out and monitor So it's not a haphazard system, but it's a systematic system. And that's going to be pretty important, as you point out.
Terrific. Well, Ezekiel Emanuel, thank you so much for joining me.
No problem. I hope this is what you wanted.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmon, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.